For that band, let me hear you clap for the band. Woo! All right, all right, all right. Somebody give the Lord a hand praise too. How about that? Woo, woo! My goodness gracious, I'm surprised the roof's still on in this place. All right, mercy. Okay, y'all can be seated just for a second. Lord, I tell you, I've been smelling that food since 8 o'clock this morning. I could eat the buttons off this shirt. So, and I want to tell you, too, the pastor has had the shortest, most powerful message today in the early service. He promised he would do it again for the second service. Let's bow for prayer. Lord, we love you. Lord, we just thank you for the things you've done for us. Lord, this morning there's so much power. There's so much enthusiasm in here, Lord, that I want us to just, right now as a church, God, we just usher in the Holy Spirit. We just ask him to fill this place, implode this place, blow the windows out of this place, God. We want to leave here a changed people. We want to leave here an adjusted mindset. We want to leave here with something in our hearts, something in our spirit, something in our guts that makes us different. So that when others look at us, God, when they look at us, they see not us. They don't see our sin. They don't see anything. They see the blood of Jesus. They see the spirit of Jesus. They see the loving hands of Jesus. They see the words that come out of our mouth. We don't have to worry about catching them because we said the wrong things, because we speak the words of Jesus. Lord, help us be more like that. Help us walk in that path. God, we love you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah, come on, come on, come on, come on. Sing it, church. How many of you glad the Lord's ever held you?
I feel found
from. Yeah, yeah.
I've been down
to that
river.
I've been there too. I've been there too.
I'm not the same.
Yeah.
Gotta go.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, sing it.
Play for me.
Listen. You've seen what's going on in Israel. You know what's going on around the world. But we can bring what's happening around the world all the way down to this county, that I have thousands of men, thousands of women that are losing their jobs in the next few months. It's going to affect hundreds of families. But I'm here today to tell you, we need to give them the message that your hope is not in your employment. Your hope is in Jesus. Let's do it again. Let him know it. If you love him, let him know it. Wow. Yeah, if you love him, let him know it. My God, he's good. God is good. And all the time. Let's just go to work. Amen. Today, the title of your message is Your Day in Court. Your Day in Court. People that go to court await something that is called a verdict. The horrible thing about the word verdict is the power that's in that word. Because a verdict can alter the very destination of your life. A guilty verdict may mean that you're imprisoned forever. And a not guilty verdict will mean that you've been set free and you have no worries of being imprisoned. Say the word verdict. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Say, let's go to court. Revelation chapter 12 refers to Satan as the accuser of the brethren. Revelation chapter 12 calls Satan the accuser of the brethren. Well, who are the brethren? The brethren, put in good old cowboy church terms, is saved folk. I'm glad today that I'm a saved folk. And Satan is the accuser of all of us. In this drama citation that I will give you today, you have been summoned to appear in court. There is a prosecuting attorney that has filed some charges against each of you. This prosecuting attorney says that he is bringing charges against you because you are guilty of some things. This particular prosecuting attorney works for the law firm called Satan in Hell. And the prosecuting attorney is Mr. Satan, and he's bringing charges against you. And unfortunately, the things that he's bringing against you today has a lot of merit. If you know it's true, say amen. It has a lot of merit. The prosecuting attorney over the years has gathered quite a bit of evidence against you and I. And that evidence reveals that we're guilty of the very things that the prosecuting attorney from Satan in hell is bringing against us. The prosecuting attorney is standing in the courtroom, and he starts by saying, "Your Honor, the person that we're bringing charges against today, for one thing, they call themselves Christians. And Your Honor, I intend to show the court today that to be a Christian means that they live to this standard. And Your Honor, I'm going to show you today that this individual has not lived up to the standard of this book, and might I even say, there's something in it called the Ten Commandments. They can't even follow those ten rules. They're guilty of breaking them, Your Honor. They've entered into a covenant with you, they say. They've entered into a contract saying that they would do all kinds of things as a Christian. And Your Honor, I have a list of wrongdoings. And it is my intent as a prosecuting attorney that today in this court, when I get through giving you the evidence, Your Honor, that you will find them guilty as charged. Now I'm going to ask you to do something with me, and I want you to step outside of the courtroom for a moment. You raised your hand in being overwhelmed and said, "I need a recess." And so I want you to step outside the courtroom for a moment, and I want to tell you that if anybody's well aware, your pastor is well aware, that life sometimes can get bothersome. That life sometimes just brings us, this is a real intellectual word, some crudola. Life just brings us some stuff sometimes. And it's not enough that it brings us one thing, but it's like something else piles on top of that thing, and something else piles on top of that thing. And it just seems that we're bombarded with the things that life just sometimes brings. And then if that's not enough, Satan sticks his head in and really knows how to pile it on. And I'll give it to you like this. Satan's never brought on anything on you that you thought, well, thank God, at least it happened at a good time. Oh, it never seems to happen at a good time. There's a reason. You see, the Bible tells you and I that some of the employees that work for Satan in hell, they're out here always, every day, trying to trip you up. Trying just to get you to do one little thing that your Heavenly Father would not be pleased with. In fact, I will tell you that the Bible says that he is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Anybody ever felt devoured? You see, he's not looking to trip you up just a little. He's looking to devour you. Can I get an amen? He's not looking just to make you slip up. He's looking to devour you. It's kind of like the story of the prodigal son. I'm going to be brief in this, but listen close. The prodigal son had everything in the world going for him. Stay with me with the analogy. His father provided his every need. His father provided him everything he could want. And he had no issues with the father. He and his father were good. But then something happened, if you'll allow me some room for a story. He turned 18. And we all know that our 18-year-olds on their birthday knew everything at that point. And really all he did was say, hey, Dad, you're getting on up in age. Rather than waiting till you die, how about giving me a little something-something that's going to come to me anyway? I'm not asking you to give me anything that's not going to be mine. I'm just saying, let's do a pay forward on this thing. So the father does it. And he goes, you know the story, and he wastes his life. He loses his money. He loses his friend. Loses everything he's got. Can't find work. And he goes and he's feeding swine. And before it's over, he's on his knees eating the same slop that he's feeding the swine. And suddenly he comes to himself. He says, why am I here? Isn't that kind of funny about sin in my life and yours? We'll just have a little bitty sin this big. I know that I've seen it among family. Suddenly, someone gets upset at somebody else, and it's this big. The next thing you know, 6 months later, it's this big. The next thing you know, it's 25 years. I still can't stand them, but the truth is I can't even remember why. Oh, that deserved a better amen. It's like there's a little sin, and I commit that sin, and I commit another sin, and I commit another sin, and I like to say it like this. First, it's this that leads to that. And then suddenly we find ourselves in the middle of this and that of Satan's tangled web, and we can't even remember how we got there. We look at our lives as Christians, and suddenly we go, well, I was saved when I was a child. I was saved when I was a teenager. How in the world did I ever get that I'm living like this? We don't even remember it. And if we're not careful, we will begin to live under the condemnation of a guilty verdict that the law firm of Satan in hell has placed on our lives as Christians. You'll come to church and think, well, I came, but I hope nobody knows about. Well, I'm here today, but thank God the preacher doesn't know about. I'm here. See. Satan will make you guilty. Let me give you an illustration. When a football team fumbles the ball and the other team recovers the fumble, there's a major shift that takes place. You see, the team that had the ball was on the offense, and they were striving to reach a goal that would lead them to victory. But they fumble the ball. Now the shift happens. You see, they've gone now from a team that's on the offense going toward a certain goal to win a victory, that now they're on the defense and they're trying to keep the other team from scoring a victory in their life. If you get it, say amen. See, God put Adam in the offensive position. And Adam fumbled the ball. And when he fumbled the ball, Satan and all of his demons recovered the fumble, and it changed the entire trajectory of history. 1 John chapter 5 verse 19 says, we know that we're children of God. Say amen. Amen. We know that we're children of God, but the world is under the control of the evil one. Repeat after me. Say, I know that I know him. I know that I love him. I know that I try to serve him, but I keep fumbling the ball. I keep fumbling the ball. And the problem is with the church today, the problem with Christians today is we continue to fumble it over and over and over again and again. I want us to take a closer look at our case. Now I'm going to tell you that recess is over, and I want us to go back into the courtroom. Will you go with me? Amen. Now, instead of the prosecuting attorney speaking, now our defense attorney is speaking on our behalf. The defense attorney is speaking, and he says, Your Honor, in defense of my client, I understand what the prosecuting attorney has brought today as evidence against my client. But, Your Honor, he's purposefully leaving out Colossians 1:13 that says, For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son that he loves. He's leaving out John 3:17, For God sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Your Honor, he's leaving out Romans 8 that says, There will be no more condemnation to those that are in Christ. Furthermore, Your Honor, on the cross at Calvary's Hill, the perfect Son of God became sin so that he might become the righteousness of God. He says, Your Honor, it's true that my client had a debt that he could not pay. But he went to a man that could pay it. And that man paid his debt. And he paid it on the very cross of Calvary. And his blood was shed so that he may not be found guilty. The judge said, Excuse me, sir, but what law firm do you represent? He says, Sir, I represent the law firm of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and all the crimes brought against my client today have been covered in the blood. And the judge slammed down his gavel and said, I find your client not guilty. Yes. Look at your neighbor saying, Not guilty. Not guilty because of the blood of Jesus. Oh, will you stand with me? Come on, let's go. I want you to repeat after me in a very loud roar. The name of Jesus is above all names. The names of Jesus is greater than every name. His name has authority in heaven, authority in earth, authority under the earth, and authority in my life. His name gives me authority over the demons of hell. His name has authority at the throne of God. His name belongs to me today for me to use in my life. He is here to see that my prayers are answered. He is here to honor what I say. For he says, if you ask anything in my name, he will do it. Give him a praise. Repeat after me. He has authorized me to use his name against all the enemy, what he brings against me. He is the name that's above all names. At the name of Jesus, Satan has to flee. His name has authority. His name has power. By his name, I can live in victory. By his name, I am free. By his name, Satan is defeated. By his name, I declare my freedom today. I am free. I am free indeed. And I have been found not guilty. By the blood of the Lamb. Praise him if you love him. Church, if you don't know him, this invitation is for you. If you do know him and you need to rededicate your life, this invitation is for you. I don't even know where this invitation would go, but if you need to come, you come. You come. Whatever you need to do, you come. Yeah, come on. You know, you can start over with him today. You can start over with him today. Right here. To rid my soul of one dark spot. To thee, whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb. Won't you sing those words, church? Sing those words. Though tossed about with many a conflict, fightings and fears within, without. God, I come, come, I come. Bow your heads with me if you would. We have several people that this morning said, Pastor, if we come forward, will you pray for us? So if you're here today to receive anointing and to be prayed for, you come at this time. Church, raise your hands toward them if you would. Father in heaven, we thank you for this, our brothers and our sisters. Father, believing God that, Lord, their only hope is in you. Lord, that their only answer is in you. And Father, we pray right now in the sweet and precious name of Jesus for your Holy Spirit and your healing power to touch their lives. Father, we speak yes and amen to their situation. Father, heal them. Lord, heal them before they even think about going back to the doctor. Lord, may they go to the doctor and the doctor said, we can't find it. But Lord, whatever your will is, we pray it according to it, because this we know. This we know, all things work together for the good of those that love the Lord and called according to his purpose. So we thank you for that. And all the church shouted amen. Amen. I've got a family that wants to dedicate their child, if you'll bring that child up here. If we have a baptism, I'm not sure if you'll come forward if you have baptism. Yeah, somebody's got a child. I think they're going to the nursery to get them. Okay. By the way, our count this morning is 709. They didn't count my little heifer, Bessie, so I'm going to say 710, ministerially speaking. She's accepted Jesus, too. I know the other day because I said, do you want to accept the Lord? She went, bah. Amen. Yes, God is good. He is good. Raise your hand toward this family. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this family wanting to come and dedicate their child. Lord, I can't imagine raising my children in today's world. Lord, I thank you. I thank you, mine are grown and gone. But Heavenly Father, this young family comes and says, it is God that we recognize that we need to be the authority in our home. Father, I pray that you bless this child. I pray that you bless him with a double anointing of your Spirit. Father, if it's within your divine will, I pray that, Lord, he be a young person in a dark world that so shows Jesus in his life that millions come to salvation. Yeah, church, shout amen. You were given a ticket. I don't know if you know what the ticket was for. Oh, wife said, shake them up. Good. Well, you come up here and draw then. Let's go. A belt buckle. Yeah. 794-8071. Anybody? Come on up here and get this belt buckle. Give it to me. Thank you. Amen. Are you a veteran? He's a veteran, Afghanistan. Amen. Let's worship. Let's stand together. We will say the blessing. And after we say the blessing, we will be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you even, Father, for what this day represents in the history of this church. Father, I thank you for revival. I thank you for healing. I thank you for a great spirit among your people. Father, thank you for the many, many, many volunteers that make this happen. Lord, today we thank you for our visitors. May they have been blessed in a special way today. And Father, Lord, not only do I thank you for this food, but Lord, I thank you for the verdict of not guilty. In Jesus' name, amen.